Let us worship God as we assemble again in the presence of our great King. We come to lift up our voices and praise to him with Psalm 85, verses 1 to 7. Psalm 85, 1 to 7, the tune is Contemplation, which is tune number 44. It opens with these words, O Lord, thou hast been favorable to thy beloved land. Jacob's captivity thou hast recalled with mighty hand. Thou pardoned, thy people hast all their iniquities. Thou all their trespasses and sins hast covered from thine eyes. So here we see these redeeming mercies. And then in verses 6 and 7, that in thee may thy people joy. Wilt thou not us revive? Show us thy mercy, Lord. To us do thy salvation give. Stand and seek God's face together in prayer. Our triune God in heaven, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, we come desiring that we indeed would be revived, that we might find our joy in thee. And we pray to that end, O God, that we would have that heavenly and divine glory set before us as the object of our faith and love. O Lord, you are a great God and a God that is full of grace and ready to pardon and to show mercy to your people. We're thankful for the Lord Jesus, who is the image of the invisible God. And it is our desire that in all things he might have the preeminence among us. We are thankful, O God, that he has been given to us. And we have the wonder of this mystery, Christ in us, the hope of glory. The one who is the door that gives us access into the holy of holies and into the heights of heaven, to be able to take up and gather our petitions and to bring them in Christ's name and to bring them dependent upon his mediation and intercession, knowing that all is sprinkled and made clean and accepted in him. O Lord, we are thankful for the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, the one who was with Christ through his whole earthly ministry, he being conceived by the Holy Ghost, and Christ, the Spirit upholding our Savior all along, receiving him at his baptism, who descended as like unto a dove, who kept and upheld him in the wilderness and all the way to the very end in the cross and present at his resurrection and then given in fullness after his ascension to be poured out upon your people. This is the Spirit of Christ, and we are thankful that he is the Spirit of promise to us, the one who was promised and who has been given a spirit of truth and of liberty and of life. We ask that this same spirit would be continue to be at work in and among the assembled people of God, accompanying all of the ordinances that have been given to take the things of Christ and to show them to us. O Lord, we believe in the Holy Ghost, and we confess our need for the presence and power of the Holy Spirit among us. And we ask, O Lord, as you have taught us, that if we ask of you, that you would give us the Holy Spirit. So grant according to our heart's desire and our petition in faith. We come, O Lord, confessing that if you should mark iniquities, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou mayest be feared. And we pray that we would be clothed in the righteous garments of the Lord Jesus Christ, that the devil, who is the accuser of the brethren, would be rebuked and caused to flee from the Lord's people, that we would have a shield put about us to protect us, that even in our times of temptation, that a way of escape would be given for our deliverance. We pray, as Christ again has taught us, deliver us from all evil. And so we pray, have mercy upon us, O Lord, and forgive and cleanse our many, many sins. We ask for your blessing upon the ordinances that have already been dispensed and administered this day, that you would follow them with your blessing, that we would be able to do the appropriate work of assessing all that has transpired in the previous service, to be able to discover the ways in which the ordinances have been made a blessing to our souls, and where they have been, to be able to rejoice and to return thanks and to make improvement of them, and where they have not, to be able to examine ourselves and to repent of our own shortcomings and to make good use of seeking and waiting and looking for such blessings to follow. O Lord, do bless the kingdom of Christ abroad. We pray for our work, our denomination's work in Sri Lanka. We are thankful for your servant who labors there in the Tamil tongue among the Hindus of the north, We are thankful for the provisions that have been made in Molotivo and in Vivonia, and for the building that is being erected, and we ask that this would be brought to completion, that all of the resources would be obtained, and that it would be a tool, an instrument for outreach in that community. We pray for the Sinhalese-speaking people in the south of the country, and many of whom are committed to Buddhism, and we ask that in both cases, in the north and the south, that the gospel would be the power of God unto salvation and overthrowing this false religion and superstition and bringing sinners into a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless us, O Lord, in our labors on the home front. We ask for your blessing upon the students of the ministry who are studying and have studied, and we ask that all of the toil and time, the prayer and study that has been devoted and is being devoted to these preparations would be made good to their own souls, that they would have the power of the word dwelling in them and would be made fit and meet instruments to then deliver that word to others. We ask for you, O Lord, to continue to raise up laborers to be sent forth into the harvest, which is white and ready to be reaped. Bless our own congregation. We ask for mercy upon those who are single adults, and we ask that they would be given their portion, that O Lord, that you would use them in the unique and wonderful ways that you have done and do in the progress of your kingdom as they devote themselves to the things of God. And we ask that they would be given much encouragement for those who desire for marriage, that godly and God-fearing husbands and wives would be raised up and covenant homes established, and that both in the estate of singleness and in the state of marriage, that all might be aimed at the glory of your name and the advance of your kingdom. And we pray that both, in both estates, that your people would be made spiritual fathers and mothers to many in the investments that are poured into the souls of those with whom we have contact. We pray for our presbytery and ask that a hedge of protection would be put about us. Provide for us, O Lord, all of the resources necessary to carry forward the work. Bless the various developments. We pray for a speedy completion of all of the logistics in bringing your servant from Scotland to Mebbin, and that this would take place quickly and that they would be settled in that work. We pray for the minister in Atlanta who prepares to retire and another to be called to step into his place, and we ask that all of that would be carried forward and that we would see the blessing of the Lord abounding on the right hand and on the left. Lord, be with us in this time of worship. Encourage, strengthen, fortify us as we seek your face. We ask in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Continue to sing through the Psalms. We come to that sequential singing that is marked out in Psalm 112, the second half, verses 6 to 10. The tune again is Soli, which is number 129. Psalm 116, beginning at verse 6, surely there is not anything that ever shall him move, the righteous man's memorial shall everlasting prove. Here we see the promise that the Lord's people will be kept by the Lord's power. Verses 6 to 10.
Oh,
Old Testament reading is found in Psalm 37. Psalm 37, beginning at verse 1, Psalm of David. Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity. For they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. So shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. And he shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, and thy judgment as the noonday. Rest in the Lord, and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. For evildoers shall be cut off, but those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall not be. Yea, thou shalt diligently consider his place, and it shall not be. But the meek shall inherit the earth, and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. The wicked plotteth against the just, and gnasheth upon him with his teeth. The Lord shall laugh at him, for he seeth that his day is coming. The wicked have drawn out the sword and have bent their bow to cast down the poor and needy and to slay such as be of upright conversation. Their sword shall enter into their own heart, and their bows shall be broken. A little that a righteous man hath is better than the riches of many wicked. For the arms of the wicked shall be broken, but the Lord upholdeth the righteous. The Lord knoweth the days of the upright, and their inheritance shall be forever. They shall not be ashamed in the evil time, and in the days of famine they shall be satisfied. But the wicked shall perish, and the enemies of the Lord shall be as the fat of lambs. They shall consume, into smoke shall they consume away. The wicked borroweth and payeth not again, but the righteous showeth mercy and giveth. For such as be blessed of him shall inherit the earth, and they that be steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his hand. I have been young, and now am old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. He is ever merciful, and lendeth, and his seed is blessed. Depart from evil, and do good, and dwell forevermore. For the Lord loveth judgment, and forsaketh not his saints. They are preserved forever, but the seed of the wicked shall be cut off. The righteous shall inherit the land, and dwell therein forever. The mouth of the righteous speaketh wisdom, and his tongue talketh of judgment. The law of his God is in his heart. None of his steps shall slide. The wicked watcheth the righteous and seeketh to slay him. The Lord will not leave him in his hand, nor condemn him when he is judged. Wait on the Lord and keep his way, and he shall exalt thee to inherit the land. When the wicked are cut off, thou shalt see it. I have seen the wicked in great power and spreading himself like a green bay tree. Yet he passed away, and lo, he was not. Yea, I sought him, but he could not be found. Mark the perfect man, and behold the upright, for the end of that man is peace. But the transgressors shall be destroyed together, and the end of the wicked shall be cut off. But the salvation of the righteous is of the Lord. He is their strength in the time of trouble. And the Lord shall help them and deliver them. He shall deliver them from the wicked and save them because they trust in him. Amen. May God bless this reading of his holy and inspired word. Let's lift up our voices again in singing praise to God from Psalm 113. We'll sing the whole of Psalm 113. The tune is Irish, which is tune number 77. So Psalm 113. Praise God, ye servants of the Lord. O praise the Lord's name, praise. Yea, blessed be the name of God from this time forth, always. From rising sun to where it sets, God's name is to be praised. Above all nations, God is high. Above heavens, his glory raised. Unto the Lord our God that dwells on high, who can compare? Himself that humbleth things to see in heaven and earth that are. We'll sing all of Psalm 113 to tune number 77.
Oh,
New Testament reading is found in Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus which are at Philippi, with the bishops and deacons, grace be unto you in peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always and every prayer of mine for you, all making request with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ, even as it is meet for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, ye all are partakers of my grace. For God is my record, how greatly I long after you all in the bowels of Jesus Christ. And this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, that ye may approve things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ unto the glory and praise of God. But I would ye should understand, brethren, that the things which happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel, so that my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. And many of the brethren in the Lord, waxing confident by my bonds, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ even of envy and strife, and some also of goodwill. The one preach Christ of contention, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my bonds, but the other of love, knowing that I am set for the defense of the gospel. What then? Notwithstanding, every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and I therein do rejoice, yea, and will rejoice. For I know that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and my hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness, as always, so now also, Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. For if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor, yet what I shall choose I wot not. For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. And having this confidence, I know that I shall abide and continue with you all for your furtherance and joy of faith, that your rejoicing may be more abundant in Jesus Christ for me by my coming to you again. Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of perdition, but to you of salvation, and that of God. For unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which ye saw in me and now hear to be in me. Amen. May God bless this reading of his holy word. Our text this afternoon is found in our first reading, our Old Testament reading, the book of Psalms, chapter 37, Psalm 37, verse 4. Our theme is, under those words, delight thyself also in the Lord. And so we are thinking this afternoon of our response to the sacrament of the Lord's Supper and the responsibilities and privileges that fall to us from that ordinance. And so our text is found in these words, delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. The English word delight. The word delight is a bright and shining and cheerful word. It's a word that brings with it resplendent joy. Something very attractive about the word and the meaning of the word delight. It is a bright and shiny word, as I say. And it especially stands out against the backdrop of much of what we find around us in this world, even in our own Christian life. Though the Christian life is taken up with things like mortification of sin. So there's open war against the devil, the world, and the flesh. There is this gruesome work of seeing sin killed in our souls. Much of the Christian life is taken up with self-denial, denying ourselves, with cross-bearing, in our following the Lord, and so on. And we could list other themes that run parallel to that. But to say all of that is not to say that the Christian life is gloomy or that the Christian life is morose. Not by a long shot. It's not a melancholy life at all. In fact, as we're going to see in this passage, and of course we could see in many others, the Christian life is one of energetic enjoyment. I mean, the Christian life is one of the purest pleasures known to mankind. It is a life of happy holiness. Well, we began our communion season last Wednesday, this past Wednesday, and we were considering there the work and ministry of the Holy Spirit in the soul of one who is being brought to faith in Christ from the Spirit of bondage and the conviction of sin through to the Spirit of adoption and the Spirit of prayer. We came to Saturday evening and we were looking at that theme of drawing near to the Lord, what it means to draw near, how it is that we draw near, the other privileges that are attached to that. This morning we looked at how we have been reconciled to God. So we go from drawing near to him to saying, okay, how is it that we are reconciled, brought together with the Lord? And then this afternoon we look at delighting in the Lord. And so if you think even a little bit reflectively, you can see how these things are tied together, culminating with this theme of delighting in the Lord. Now, this Psalm of David, and specifically verse 4, falls into a context where David is conflicted. So this is similar to what we saw last evening in that Psalm of Asaph. He is saying, fret not thyself because of evildoers. So the context is one of turbulence. The context is one of being conflicted. He's saying, do not be unhinged by all that you see around you in the wicked world, for they shall soon be cut down. So don't be conflicted, rather cleave to the Lord. And this is really what follows in a cascade of exhortations. Trust in the Lord, delight in the Lord, commit thy way to the Lord, rest in the Lord, and so on. It's all ways of saying we need to cling to the Lord himself. In Romans chapter 5, Paul has something similar to say, beginning at verse 3. These will be familiar words to you. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also. So here again, the context of a conflicted or difficult state. But we glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. And so we want to focus our attention on what it means to delight in the Lord. First thing that we'll ask is, what are the prerequisites to delighting in the Lord, the prerequisites of delight. After all, delighting in the Lord is not something natural to us. It's something supernatural. Remember what we heard this morning about being alienated from God, being enemies of God in our minds by wicked works. That reconciliation that comes in the gospel is essential for there to be any delight in the Lord. Otherwise, God is repugnant, God is abhorrent, God is at odds with anything and everything that the unbeliever knows and loves. And so, in the verse prior to verse 4, it speaks of trusting in the Lord. It's talking about the exercise of faith in the Lord, and that, of course, presupposes the knowledge of the Lord. So you can't delight in something that you have no knowledge of. If you go to the South Pacific or tropics somewhere and say to a native who's never even heard of ice cream, "Do you love ice cream?" They can't with integrity say, "Yes, I love ice cream," if they have no idea what ice cream is. So there has to be a knowledge of the Lord. In order to draw near to the Lord and to delight in the Lord, we have to know who he is. And, of course, we find that knowledge of him in the Holy Scriptures. In the Gospel of John, chapter 5, you'll remember the words of the Lord Jesus Christ in verse 39, where it says, "Search the Scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me." Searching the Scriptures brings the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, this searching, this knowledge is reflective. So it's a seeking of the Lord, not just having facts handed out or distributed to us, right? It's not just being hearers. So there are people that can listen to a sermon, and then you give them an exam, and they can answer the questions about what the minister has said in the sermon. Well, that's one thing. But to actually have a knowledge of these things, a firsthand, personal, experiential, believing knowledge of them, is something altogether different. It is reflective, it's seeking, it's obtaining, it's the exercise and diligence of the soul. It'll also bring with it watchfulness against sin. So if we're delighting in the Lord, then we're going to find what is opposite to the Lord detestable. So if you love sin, you hate God. If you hate sin, you love God. If you're delighting in the Lord, you're going to find sin detestable, which means you're going to be watching against it as God gives you grace. In Psalm 85 and verse 8, "I will hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace unto his people and to his saints. But let them not turn again to folly." Right? There's a watchfulness. We think of sin as something that spoils our communion and fellowship with the Lord, that detracts from our delight in him. It sours that delight. I mean, ladies, if you make a cake, and it's not an ordinary cake, it's a masterpiece. I mean, you have the inside and the outside is very special. And so you make for a special occasion this cake and you set it on the table. And it's all ready, it's all beautiful, and you go off to do something else and come back, you know, 15 minutes or a half hour later and find out that the dog has put his paws up on the table and licked over the top of your cake and taken a few bites out of it. You're going to say the cake is spoiled, right? We can't just cover this over and serve it to whoever it was for. It is wrecked, right? It is spoiled. This is the way that we view sin. Sin is something we watch against because it spoils the fellowship and delight that we find in the Lord. Solomon says this in Ecclesiastes 10, verse 1, "Dead flies cause the ointment of the apothecary to send forth a stinking savor. So doth a little folly him that is in reputation for wisdom and honor." You know, that bit of folly spoils the bit of wisdom. And so we are to We need to be setting our sights on the Lord, which means taking our sights off of the things of this world. So we delight in the Lord. Now we can think in terms of our relationships. We're delighting in Him as a bride delights in her husband. So a bride is excited. She finds delight in her bridegroom and vice versa. We are the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ. Our disposition is one that is geared toward delighting in Him. We think of His names. Jesus is called the desire of all the nations. And we go through the titles and names that belong to Him, and they increase and strengthen the delight that we find in Him. We think of His beauty. You know, He is fairer than all the sons of men, as we are so often repeating, the chief among 10,000. We are like the Queen of Sheba before Solomon. We come to the Lord, and we have to say, the half of it wasn't ever told us. Far better than we ever knew before. This is delighting in the Lord. It is something that is increasing within the Christian life. We delight in His wisdom. You have wise friends, I trust. And despite the fact that they're wise and have much help and counsel to give us, they are fallible. And they are capable of giving foolish counsel that would be fruitless. But this is one who is infinite in unerring wisdom. And He is wise when He chastens us, and He's wise in the storms of life that he produces. He is Christ, the pilot, who is steering the ship to bring us into the haven that He has designed. We delight in His wisdom. We delight in His power. He has the ability to deliver what He's promised. There are many things that your friends and others may long to do for you. And I've probably said to some of you myself, I wish I had the ability to do thus and such for you, to take something away or to give something that is needed. There's this desire, but an inability to deliver. Not so with the Lord. We delight in His power. He can give and does all that He's promised. We delight in His goodness. Those who are closest to us are also those who bring us pain. Doesn't matter who they are, but God is good, and His mercies endure forever, and all that He brings is good through and through. We delight in His love. We've seen it set on beautiful display in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper this day, where the declaration and the declaration of God's love has been broadcast before us. It has been signified and sealed to us in His covenant of grace. We delight in that love. We delight in God's sufficiency. We are complete. We are complete in Him. He and He alone is fully adequate for all that our hearts desire. Isaiah 43 and verse 2. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee, for I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. The Lord is one who is fully sufficient for us. And so we see some of the prerequisites. These are things that must be known, savingly and believingly, in order for us to delight in the Lord. Secondly, we have some properties of delight, some properties describing the character, the nature, the essence, if you will, of delight. When I said earlier that love or that delight is something that brings resplendent joy with it, why do we say that sort of thing? Delight is an expression of love. We love something. We are enjoying loving something. One way to describe delight, or we esteem it. So we delight in it. We value it. We esteem it and consider it something that is to be prized. Delight brings with it the concept that we've been hearing yesterday and today of communion with the Lord. So you can't delight in the company of someone that you don't have contact with. right? There's a delight in communion, in giving and receiving, in the fellowship that is to be had with the Lord. And this delight, then, is something thoroughly sensible, right? This is rational. This is rationality at its best, because the object of our delight is Jehovah. There are a lot of things that we delight in this world. We might delight in the gifts of food and rest and sunshine and people and all sorts of other things. But when we're talking, as we are here in verse 4, about delighting ourselves in the Lord, we are being raising ourselves above all of that, above everything else in the world and all the other people that are in the world. Above all of this, we delight in the Lord. The covetous delight in the prospect of increasing their wealth. They're engrossed by it. And yet, in a sense, it's irrational to make this their master, to make this their chief delight and goal. Why? Well, what does Proverbs 13 tell us? Verse 7, there is that maketh himself rich, yet hath nothing. Right? There is a vanity to riches, uncertainty to them, that they cannot deliver us from what we need most. But the Lord is our never-failing portion. We also have to acknowledge, though, that this delight, while perfectly rational and wonderful, it is also intermittent. So it is something that waxes and wanes. It is something that fluctuates within the Christian. So this is not describing what ought to be, but it's rather describing realistically what is in our hearts and lives. There's a fluctuation in our delight in the Lord, and it is 100% due to us and not him. It's not because his delightfulness goes up and down, is hidden and exposed. It's because of our own erring hearts that our joy is interrupted, that God's face is hidden. It is because of our sin that this is the case, and yet it is the case because of our sin. And yet the Lord promises to us, even looking at the realism of an intermittent delight in the Lord. In Isaiah 29, is it? Yes, verse 19, where it says, the meek also shall increase their joy in the Lord, and the poor among them shall rejoice in the Holy One of Israel. Nevertheless, the Lord says, whatever we know of the fruit of the Holy Ghost in reference to joy, the joy of the Lord, which is our strength, whatever we have known in the past, it is increasable. So it is our joy, as this text says, can and does increase. That is our joy in the Lord. And if that should seem obvious to us, because we know that heaven is a sea of joy. It is the atmosphere is joy. All that belongs to it is delighting in the Lord himself. And so if that is going to be exponentially more than we know now, and if even that can increase, then of course our joy and delight in the Lord can increase here as well. And that should strengthen and give us hope and pursuits. It is, of course, something that is confined to Christians. So it's not part of the world. We covered that this morning. We have many shared sorrows with worldlings, with the fallen world. We all lose loved ones. We have the affliction of body. We have a whole wide array and assortment of different afflictions. Those sorrows, or types of sorrow at least, are shared. But we never are able to share the peculiar joys that belong to the Christian life. Because, as Paul says, if you don't have Christ, then you can't have joy in Christ. And if you don't have joy in Christ, then you've never had real joy. at all. And if you don't have hope that extends beyond this present world, then in Paul's words, you are most miserable. How can there be joy without that hope being connected with it? And so there are some properties here, some characteristics of what it means to delight in the Lord. It involves meditation, of course, meditating on God himself. So we have that in Psalm 63 and verse 6. I could probably quote the metrical better than the prose, but here it is in the prose version. Psalm 63, verse 6, "When I remember thee upon my bed and meditate on thee in the night watches." So it's meditating on the Lord, meditating on God himself. People do not realize, none of us realize as much as we ought, that the Lord is a bottomless ocean. You can never get bored with meditating on the Lord himself. You can never exhaust it. The problem is this: we are too content with floating on the surface. We are content with the common, the easy, the familiar. And we perhaps will rehearse those things. We're not willing to plunge, to go down and down and down and down into the depths of which there is no bottom. To be discontent with scratching the surface. I mean the surface of the knowledge of God himself. And when is the last time you meditated thinking about the attributes of God? When is the last time you meditated on the aseity of God? Now, I've preached a whole sermon on divine aseity at one point. It's been a long time. Right? Aseity, two Latin words, the preposition a from, and then se, the reflexive pronoun, himself. So from himself. God is from himself. Well, that seems simple enough. But what does it mean? For God to be entirely independent of creation. For God, as I said this morning, to have his existence in his essence, to exist necessarily, and to be the source himself of his own divine being and glory, to be therefore, of course, uncreated and so on. And there's all sorts of things that go with that, and some of it seems abstract, and part of it's because we're lazy and we don't want to think hard about what God shows us in his word about himself. You think about the eternity of God, and you can think easily about going into the past forever, and you can think easily about the basic concept of going into the future forever, but that is not the eternity of God. And how much do we know of it? And I'm merely making the point that meditating on the Lord is part of the way in which we enter into delighting in him. Rather than viewing these things as kind of crusty, you know, very abstract concepts, they contain in them some of the richest, sweetest, most savory expressions of personal devotion and piety possible. Right? There is warm and savory devotion to be had and our understanding of who God is. And so in our secret retirement, we see what is invisible, meditating on the Lord, delighting in him. We prize his ordinances. Job says that he esteemed the Lord's word more than his necessary food. The psalmist says in Psalm 119 that if he hadn't been afflicted, he would have never understood God's statutes. So he said, it was worth it. I've come to understand the word of God more thoroughly through these things. The psalmist says elsewhere that he finds the courts of God to be lovely and amiable, to be the delight of his heart. And so there's prizing the places that God has found, his ordinances. As I said earlier, it brings with it a decreased delight in the world. You can't have two. Jesus says you can't serve two masters. You'll love the one and hate the other, or despise the one and love the other. You can't have both God and mammon, or any two masters that are held in competition with the Lord. It means that we will be Delighting in him means that we're willing to submit to him, to submit to his will. What is it that he's asking of us and requiring of us? There's those words in at the end of Hebrews 10. We think of Hebrews 11 in the catalog that's given to us there. But the author to the book of Hebrews is describing at the end of chapter 10 the afflictions that the Hebrew Christians willingly underwent. So verse 34, "For ye had compassion of me in my bonds." And what did that lead to? "And took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that ye have in heaven a better and an enduring substance." There's a submission to the Lord. Of course, delighting in the Lord brings with it having our heart in heaven. We saw in Philippians 1, to depart and be with Christ is far better. So that's not up for debate. That's not up for discussion. To depart and be with the Lord is far better, though Paul says that to remain is often far more necessary. But our heart is in heaven. Our desire is to be with the Lord when he is pleased to bring that to pass. We see this in a few places. One is 2 Corinthians 5, verse 4. "For we that are in this tabernacle," right, this body, this tent, "For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened. Not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life." You see that tension that's there. Our heart is in heaven. Thirdly, the promise that's given to those who delight. "Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart." He shall give thee the desires of thine heart. So we see a promise attached to this principle. Now, when I was a young person, and I grew up in the church, as I've probably said before, I doubt I missed a Sabbath morning, Sabbath evening, or midweek service more than could be counted on both hands in my whole upbringing, right? From the time I was little, all the way up through to adulthood. And so I was very familiar with these passages. And at least among the young, or my compatriots at the time, there was a tendency, I think, to come to Psalm 37 and verse 4 and think to oneself, well, if we delight in the Lord, whatever that means, then you'll get the desires of your heart. So if we are doing some things that delight in the Lord, then we will get a Corvette. Or we will get, you know, some other thing that are the desires of our heart, right? So we're thinking you do something for God, and then God's going to give you the thing you want. This is crass, it's depraved, it's carnal, it's terrible. But this was the kind of mentality in my unconverted state and those of some of my friends that we were inclined toward. That is not what the Bible is saying at all. Delighting in the Lord redirects the desires of your heart. Delighting in the Lord actually redirects your desires. So your chief pleasures are transformed by delighting in the Lord. And you are interested in glorifying him, not gratifying your sinful and sensual appetite, not somehow delivering what's desired to your carnal mind, but rather the reward that's described here, God giving us the desires of our heart, is suited to the duty of delighting in him. And so if we're delighting in the Lord, that is going to be the desire. The desires will be things that are attached to the Lord, and therefore, those are the things that will be given to us. So we can think in terms of God giving what is truly good. God will give his people what is truly good, not what we think is good, but what he says is good. Psalm 84:11, for the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. Listen, no good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. Now, that includes the good thing of affliction at times. Affliction at times is not only necessary, at times it is a gift. Now it takes faith, it takes grace to ever say, much less believe such a thing. But the Bible tells us, James 1, verse 2, my brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into diverse temptations. And then he goes on to explain why. Here's all of the benefit that God is going to bring as a result of those things. So, delighting in the Lord at times will mean deferring to the Lord when he wills for us to have our faith tried. Him giving us the desires of our heart include him giving us what is truly good. It also includes God's timing. God's designs are the very, very best. We are absolutely convinced at times that we know emphatically what is best and when we need what. And we've often discovered how foolish, in fact, we are. It's Isaiah 30, verse 18, and therefore will the Lord wait, and he may be gracious unto you, and therefore will he be exalted, that he may have mercy upon you? For the Lord is a God of judgment. Blessed are all they that wait for him. So it is the Lord's will at times for us to wait on his timing. A few chapters later, chapter 35, verse 10, the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy. Upon their heads they shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. It is in the Lord's timing. We also need to recognize that when the Lord says he'll give us the desires of our heart, that it is actually what he gives is disproportionate to our original desires. What do I mean by that? To use Paul's word, he will give us above and even beyond what we can think, what we can conjure up, dream about, and even imagine. The Lord is able to give beyond those things. So the desires of our heart are not only satiated, the doors are blown off in providing for us out of the Lord's goodness. And it is something that we find in this life, partially, and we find in the life to come, fully. Now, there are hindrances that, of course, come to this. There's the hindrance of idolatry. So you have your idol, and your little white knuckles are exposed with a clenched fist as you cling to that idol. That will be a hindrance to delighting in the Lord, whatever that idol may be, whoever that idol may be, or whatever that idol may be. The world is also an obstacle to delighting in the Lord. You can't have friendship with the world and friendship with God. There's in our study of Judges some time ago, years ago now, there's that account that's given to us in chapter 18. You'll remember it. The man Micah. And in verse 24, he says this. So they're asking Micah what ails him. And he said, ye have taken away my gods, which I made, and the priest, and ye are gone away. And what have I more? And what is this that ye say to me? What aileth thee? He's saying, you have taken away what I had prized most, and my life is worthless. And I'm spent, and I'm finished, and I'm done, and I'm fed up, and I don't care about anything or anyone else. because these have been taken away from me. Well, that's a hindrance to delighting in the Lord, isn't it? Formality and formalism is a hindrance to delighting in the Lord. Merely being content with going through routine without having your heart and mind engaged in such things. Unbelief is an obstacle to delighting in the Lord. We could go on and on. But here we're told to delight in the Lord. He will give us the desires of our heart. We come to the Lord's table. This is what we're doing. We're delighting in Christ. We're saying, here is a Savior. Here is a Redeemer. Here is blood shed. Here is a perfect sacrifice. Here is the love of God for my soul. And we come with desires. We want to see more of Christ, receive more of Christ, benefit more of His grace, and so on. And is it not the case that as we come delighting in the Lord to His table, that He often sends us away? He sends us away having given us the desires of our heart. It is true. He causes us to taste and see that the Lord is good. So we do have in our pilgrimage gratification, but it's a spiritual, incalculable joy that gratifies us, delighting to receive the Lord, and in receiving Him, to receive the desires of our heart. Much of this pertains to us redirecting our hearts into the pursuit of true joy. Right? We're having to constantly yank the steering wheel of our souls from driving, as it were, off the cliff in pursuit of vanities and redirecting our pursuit to true joy, to saying, here is where God has provided for us the source of genuine delight. It's in Himself. Nothing less than Him. Nothing lower than Him. It is the Lord Himself. And the Lord's Supper centers us. The Lord's Supper brings us back and enables us to focus our attention where it ought to have been all the time, in delighting in the Lord Himself. And we need to carry that. We need to carry that from the supper with us. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and He shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Let's stand for prayer. Our Lord and our God, there is a great deal that You have given to us in this life, a great deal that You have promised to yet give us in the life to come, much that has brought us joy in believing. And yet You have reinforced for us again and again that there is nothing more, nothing bigger, nothing greater than having given us Yourself. You've taught us to say and to pray, whom do we have in heaven beside Thee? There is none upon the earth that we desire more than Thee. O Lord, make this to be true of us, that we would learn more and more of what it means to delight in the Lord, and in delighting to find all of the desires of our heart satisfied, our souls gratified. We pray, O God, that You would enable us to take away the tokens of mercy and blessing poured out upon Your people on this Sabbath day. Enable us to prize them and to count them precious, and to be led to praise and adore You for them. We ask in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen. Let's sing together from Psalm 85. The second half of the psalm, verses 8 to 13. Psalm 85, verses 8 to 13. The tune is Saint Bernard, number 107. Verse 12, Psalm 85, verse 12, yea, what is good? The Lord shall give. Our land shall yield increase. Justice to set us in his steps shall go before his face. So we're singing to God's praise. Psalm 85, beginning at verse 8 through to the end, and to tune number 107. Benediction. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.